YAF-TV. I'm sitting here with Dr. Burt Folsom. He's from Hillsdale College. And I wanted to ask you about some of the things we've been hearing about in the media about economics and history. We actually had an interesting talk this morning about the stimulus package in the context of FDR and his programs. What would you say history tells us about the stimulus package and how it's worked compared to FDR's programs?
Stimulus packages have never worked. And some of it is logical, Ron. You can't, because a stimulus package is really a redistributionist package. It's not a creating package. What creates wealth is when you create it. A new invention, a new enterprise, it creates jobs, something that wasn't there before. A stimulus package redistributes the money from people who have it and would be inclined probably to spend it on something. Even if they put it in the bank, it could be used for the banks could use it for mortgages. And then use that money that they could spend one way, you take it, and the government spends it another way. Government does not spend money as efficiently and as effectively as people do with their own money. And therefore, usually stimulus packages result in politicization, that is, you build roads in a particular congressman's district, or you have enterprises that are popular and may not be widely used. So some stimulus money sometimes builds useful roads. You get things here and there, but generally speaking, it's not used very effectively. Plus, you have bureaucrats in Washington siphoning off large chunks of it. So with the tax hikes that you get on everybody else to pay for the stimulus package, the loss of money from the private sector to send the money to the public sector, stimulus package,
well,
you simply don't want.
Yeah, and usually these tax hikes are put on the rich or corporations. Now, why is that particularly bad for young people? Why would that hurt them most, or people who are actually starting out in life?
Well, first of all, people who start out in life like to think the sky's the limit. It's sad when you see people lowering the ceiling, and they say, no, you can't make this much, or we're going to tax you. The problem that we faced with Roosevelt, for example, was if we begin the 1930s, that the highest tax rate was 25%. Then that was the maximum anybody had to pay in 1930 and 31, and even through 32. Then the tax rate was, at the top level, was raised to 63%, then 79%, then 81%, and by the time Roosevelt died, the top rate on taxation was 94% on all income over $200,000. Well, when you tell someone who earns $1 million that on the last $800,000 he gets to keep $6,000, he gets to keep $48,000, and he has to give $750,000 to the government, it affects the way he invests his money, and we do not get jobs created the same way.
So you're actually saying that taxing the rich more, we actually probably, I mean, the revenue numbers probably are also interesting to look at, but we actually get less jobs when we do that. So are you suggesting that now we're in an economic downturn, we might need to look at tax cuts to stimulate the economy, get young people back to work?
I think so. I think that because we have the second highest corporate tax rate in the world, and you add on to that an income tax rate and a capital gains tax. See, so you're hitting people with their income, their capital gains, estates at the end, and then you have that 35% corporate tax, which is higher than every other country in the world except for Japan. You create a situation where people do not have adequate incentives to invest. And not surprisingly, Ron, you make reference to corporations. Corporations invest a lot overseas because that's where the money is. They would like to invest here in the United States. Profits are overseas. Giveaways are here in the United States.
But Dr. Folsom, I think like taxes are really controversial, obviously, now, and whether or not we should cut taxes. What does history tell us about tax cuts working? Do they work, or is that just, I mean, solve the controversy for us?
They do, and there's a lot of evidence. Let me give you one example. We had 12% unemployment in 1921, and we cut the tax rates. And we cut the tax rates from 73% to ultimately 25%. In 2 years, the unemployment went from 12% to 2.4%. So it can work quickly. And inventions like radio and then expansion of things like refrigerators, vacuum cleaners, and then ultimately we get, even scotch tape and sliced bread, all of this was in the 1920s. And we get entrepreneurs who were told they get to keep most of what they earn. They went out and invested, and we see tremendous economic development. Same thing happened in the 80s with Ronald Reagan. I like, I like the book, The End of Prosperity by Steve Moore and Art Laffer, because they do a good job of showing how the tax cuts under President Reagan and under President Bush in 2003 both created huge revenue boosts to the government and at the same time stimulated job creation by telling entrepreneurs, you get to keep most of what you make.
Dr. Folsom, thanks for sitting down with us. You can hear him at any of our conferences. He speaks on history and helps correct liberal revisionist history. And you should definitely think about coming to our conferences to hear Dr. Folsom speak.
Thank you, Ron.